Bob, I'm going to start off just with a welcome home. You know, it's always nice to have you here on WGN.
Yeah, it's you can't just pop on a plane anymore and fly home. So yeah,
right.
It's been a while since I've been in Chicago. So I miss it. I miss it.
Yeah, I want to talk about that a little bit later on. But I'm understanding that this is a big day for you. You got the needle, right?
I get the shot today. I'm 91, and I've been waiting, and it's the first shot I ever look forward to.
Right. Now, are you going to a doctor's office to do this? Because I saw you on Conan O'Brien talking about how you didn't want to go to a grocery store or, you know, someplace like that to get your shot.
Now, my incredible secretary found a place nearby. So, yeah, because I was reading about, you know, I saw Steve Martin was on and he got his shot. He's 75 and I'm 91, and I'm hearing about all these people that are getting their shots. And so Cheryl, my secretary, said she found this place, and I'm looking forward to it.
You've pretty much been home during this whole quarantine, right? I mean, you've been yes. pretty safe during this whole time, not going outside, right?
Yeah, and I'm getting tired of it.
What have you been doing at home? What have you been doing to keep busy?
Well, I tell you, football saved my life. I mean, it came out at just the right time. And you got two or three games every Sunday. And then when it gets down toward the Super Bowl, then you've got Saturday and Sunday. And I was watching yesterday, and there was an ad for Poland Springs water. Springs. I'm not plugging them. It just was an ad for Poland. And I thought to myself, I was an accountant at the Glidden Company in Chicago. And I was in charge of petty cash. And, you know, the salesman would come in off the road and they'd give me a receipt for the lodge, for the motel, or the gas, or dinner, whatever. And I'd give them cash. And then it was up to me to balance what was left in the cash drawer with the receipts I had. And they never balanced. So this went on for like 2 months. And finally one day it was under $1.50. So I took $1.50 out of my pocket and I put it in petty cash. And I went home at 5 o'clock with everybody else. But then the next day it was over $2. So I took the $2 out. So Mr. Hutchinson, he was head of the accounting department, and he said, my name is George Roberts. So he said, George, these are not sound accounting principles. And I said, well, Mr. Hutchinson, I don't think I'm cut out for accounting. And they had offered me a job in Poland Springs, Maine. Glidden Company had a plant. And I turned it down and I said, no, I got to try this comedy thing. I've got to find out if I'm any good at this.
Wow. How about that?
Wow. Yeah.
That's amazing. So when you see the Poland Springs ad, then that takes you back to that critical juncture in your career, huh?
That could have been me. Yeah. In Poland Springs.
That's
although
really...
I don't think it wouldn't have worked because I'm not a good accountant, and I would have screwed up somehow, and they would have fired me. So,
well, that goes back to your really like your early roots here.
Yeah, that was like 58.
Wow,
1958.
How about that? So, but it was just a few years after that you did your legendary Button Down Mind album. Which still holds records. No other comedy artist has ever won Album of the Year, Record of the Year, Best New Artist of the Year. You still are the only one that's ever done that. So how do you go from almost getting assigned to Poland Springs to becoming a Grammy Award winner in just a couple of years?
Well, that was Dan Sorkin. You remember Danny. Danny was one of the top DJs in Chicago, and he was meeting with the Warner Brother record people. And he said, I have this friend of mine, I think he's funny. And they said, well, have him put some of his stuff down on tape and we'll listen to it. So at that time I had three routines. I had just written these routines because they struck me funny. I really had no outlet for them. But it was the Abe Lincoln routine. It was the submarine commander and the driving instructor. So I put it on a tape and gave it to Danny, and Danny played it for the Warner Brother record people. And they said, okay, all right, we'll give you a recording contract. And they said, we'll record you at your next nightclub. And I said, well, that's a problem because I've never played a nightclub. And they said, well, we'll have to get you into a nightclub. And which was, no one wanted to take a chance on a stand-up who'd never been in a nightclub. They finally found a place in Houston, Texas, at Tidelands, which no longer is there. And I went down in January of 1960 with all the bravado I could muster to pretend like I knew what I was doing, and recorded the album. And as you said, Dean, it came out and it went crazy. It just went, it was insane.
I'm trying to imagine what kind of chutzpah, courage, whatever you call it, of somebody who has never done this before, to go in there and give it a shot like that. Were you terrified when you were going in?
Beyond terrified. But you very, very soon learned that you can't let on that you don't know what you're doing. So, I mean, if the audience is not sure that you know what you're doing, you're dead meat. So you have to, with all the bravado, as I said, I could muster, I put my head down and I went ahead and did it. And then it went crazy. I just read the other day, I never realized there was, it was number one on the Billboard charts for 3 months.
That's amazing.
I had never heard that statistic before. And it was like every day was New Year's. It was, it was how many Sullivan shows you want to do. You want to do a television show? And what Warners would do, because they were a music company, so they would say, "Oh, there's the pause, and we can pick up a second there, and we'll pick up a half second here." And it always bothered me because it wasn't the way I heard it. And in 1995, Showtime approached me. And they said, what would you like to do? And I said, I'd like to do the album the way I heard it in my head with the pauses. Because, musically, the pauses sometimes are more important than the sound. And so this gave me this, the one that's coming out now is the digital version of that 1995 show.
I want you to know I'm in my home office right now, and I've got pictures of people I love and things like that around here. This is right by my desk. I don't know if you can see this. I'm gonna try to hold this close.
I remember that. Yeah.
This is you with a WGN camera. You were nice enough to autograph this to me many years ago. What do you remember from that? What was your WGN connection?
There was a strike in Chicago, and they couldn't broadcast the Emmy Awards. So they did it in the lobby of WGN, in the foyer. And someone called me and said, "Would you get up and entertain?" And nobody knew who I was, but they knew I'd done this Abe Lincoln routine. So they asked me to repeat it. So I did, and it got quite a reaction. Alex Dreyer was, as a matter of fact, was he was the host, and he said, "What do you mean there's no talent in Chicago?" And out of that, I got a contract with Red Quinlan at ABC, and we did a Man on the Street show with Tom Racine. We were on for 16 weeks, and we were opposite Today Today Show and Captain Kangaroo.
Oh wow!
So, yeah, I know.
Heavy hitters.
So we were on for 16 weeks, five shows a week for 16 weeks, and we got one postcard. And I don't even know if it was getting out of the studio, you know.
Talking about that Lincoln, I was thinking about your Lincoln bit that you did, that's so classic, that's still so timely. You know, with all the talk of the presidential inaugural and everything that we've been through, what have you must have come in contact with presidents of the United States through the years. I don't know, have you been to the White House, you know, those kinds of things that, you know, celebrities normally are able to take advantage of.
Well, now that I've met quite a few, I never met JFK. I campaigned a lot for JFK. I met Teddy, never met Nixon. I met Ford, never met Carter. Met Reagan, George W. And as a matter of fact, I made a movie. Buck Henry wrote a movie called The First Family with Gilda Radner and Madeline Kahn. And I happened to have it in case we were going to talk about it.
What?
I played the president. He was so unpopular that they had to put my head on a stick and push it through the top of the limousine.
Oh.
People were throwing things at it. That's how popular he was as a president. There it is.
Look at that. Yeah. And I got to say, you're the first person I've ever interviewed that, you know, showed me their disembodied head in the middle of an interview. I got to ask you, I'm looking at that picture, I guess it would be over your right shoulder, and I'm wondering who that is.
Oh yeah, that's we got that from a guy. He sent it to me, an artist, and he's a comedian, he's a clown, and he's in the circus because there's a pillar there, and he's kind of sad faced, and if you look real close, his shirt is ripped, and inside is nothing.
Oh wow! Wow. Do you have memorabilia there in your office? Do you have your three Grammy awards, and do you keep stuff like that? A lot of people, you know, don't want to display that.
My prized possession is it's a letter from JFK. I appeared at his birthday in June of 1963, and he sent me a letter with a White House dictionary, and just he wrote, enjoyed it greatly. And then, 5 months later, he was dead.
Wow. Bob, how much do you miss being on the road? I mean, I know you're not doing as much stand-up as you used to, but, you know, now you can't do anything.
No, I haven't done anything for, for over a year. I miss it. I really, really, you know, Gene, that's where I started, with stand-up. It kind of got lost that I did stand-up, you know, because of the television shows, which I'm very proud of. But I was always proud of being a stand-up, and I miss it, yeah. And it's a real question as to when people are going to be able to sit next to absolute strangers in an arena.
Yeah, that's you know, I remember being backstage. I remember being backstage at your shows, and you know, some of the comedians, like the, you know, names that you would know today, were back there, and they were like, you know, little schoolboys. They were so excited to meet Bob Newhart, you know, because they idolize you. I mean, you are the comedian's comedian. Who was like that for you when you were, you know, first getting started? Do you remember who?
Oh, Benny, Jack Benny had to be because Jack, you know, people said our timing was very similar, but you can't learn timing. You hear it in your head. You can't be taught timing. I admire Jack because he was so brave as a comedian. Jack wasn't afraid of silence. You know, he knew exactly how to tell the story, and he would take the time to tell the story. And the other comedians would get nervous if there hadn't been a laugh for like 5 seconds, but not Jack. He's the bravest comedian I've ever seen work.
Yeah,
because he wasn't afraid of silence.
You're such a supporter of the city of Chicago and St. Ignatius and, you know, things that are near and dear to you, Loyola. How do you think Chicago influenced the person that you became?
I think the big thing was don't put on airs. You know, don't think you're something special.
Your friendship with the great Don Rickles is legendary. And I don't know, you've told so many stories about Rickles. Is there a side of Don Rickles or something you think would surprise us about your best friend all these years?
If Don thought that he really offended somebody, he would feel terrible. He would just feel terrible. It was the assumption of risk. You know, if you went to see a Don Rickles show, yeah, you might hit you with something, you know. I remember one time Ginny and I were in the booth at the Sahara with Barbara Rickles, and Don was on stage. And there was one guy in front and had this terrible hairpiece, just the worst. It looked like a animal had died on his head, you know. But Don kept walking by him. And I'm sitting in the booth and I'm going, doesn't he see the guy? I mean, it's the worst hairpiece I've ever seen in my life. And Don just stops and he looks down at the guy and he said, no one would ever guess, sir.
What do you think the Bob Newhart legacy is going to be?
Oh, I really, I haven't thought about it. If I help some young guys coming up, that's a compliment. And because I learned from watching good comedians. So if they learn something from me, that's part of the tradition.
I always enjoy catching up and talking to you. I'm glad you got your shot. I'm happy to hear that you're minutes away from getting your vaccination.
The first one.
Right. Part one. So, you know, that's terrific. I'm so happy that you're doing well. I'm so happy you're staying sane during this crazy time. I really appreciate you taking some time.
Thank you, Gene. It's always great talking to you. I look forward to it.